some classes of functions that are Riemann integrable. It is sufficient for a function f to be integrable over the closed interval a comma b if it belongs to any one of the following classes of functions. Classes of function is continuous on the closed interval a comma b. Classes of functions monotonic on the closed interval a comma b. Classes of bounded functions on the closed interval a comma b with a finite set of points of discontinuity. Classes of bounded functions on closed interval a comma b with set of points of discontinuity having a finite number of limit points. We shall now prove that every continuous function on the closed interval a comma b is Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b. Before to prove this theorem, we shall recall the following results. The first one is necessary and sufficient condition for Riemann integrability. The statement is necessary and sufficient condition for a bounded function f to be Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b is for each epsilon greater than 0 there exists a partition p of the closed interval a comma b such that 0 less than or equals to u of p comma f minus l of p comma f is less than epsilon. The second result is Borel's theorem. If a function f is continuous on the closed interval a comma b, then for each epsilon greater than 0, there exists a partition p of the closed interval a comma b such that modulus of f of x1 minus f of x2 is less than epsilon for x1 comma x2 belong to IR where I suffix R is any sub interval of the partition P. Here the important point is these two points, namely x1 and x2, must belong to the same sub-interval of the partition P of the closed interval a comma b. Every continuous function on the closed interval a comma b is Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b. Proof: let f be a continuous function on the closed interval a comma b. Since f is continuous function on the closed interval a comma b, by Borel's theorem, for each epsilon greater than 0, there exists a partition P is equals to the set consisting of the partition points x0 equals to a, comma x1, comma x2, comma so on, xr minus 1, comma xr, so on, xn is equals to b of the partition a, comma b, such that modulus of f of xr minus f of xr minus 1 is less than b minus a. Let us call it as inequality 1, where xr minus 1 and this xr belong to the same subinterval ir. It is true for every r from 1 to n. Since f is continuous on the closed interval a comma b, by boundedness theorem, it is bounded in that interval and attains its bounds at least once in that interval. For this partition P, let small mr and capital Mr be the infimum and supremum of the function in the rth subinterval IR, where IR is the rth subinterval that is equals to the closed interval xr minus 1 comma xr. Since f is continuous function on the closed interval a comma b, it is continuous in each and every subinterval of the closed interval a comma b, and in particular it is continuous in the rth subinterval ir. Therefore, there exist two points, say alpha r comma beta r, belong to ir, such that f of alpha r is equals to mr and f of beta r is equals to capital mr. Let us consider the x and y axis, and this is a curve which is a continuous curve or continuous function. Let us consider the closed interval a comma b, and we find these are the points on the x-axis, and assume that this is the rth subinterval ir. This is small mr, which is the infimum of the function f in the rth subinterval ir, and capital Mr is the supremum of the function f in the rth subinterval ir. Now, what are alpha r and beta r? Let us consider this is alpha r, which is in the rth subinterval, whose functional value is f of alpha r, that is nothing but the infimum, namely mr. What's the highest value here? This is the least value, so infimum of the function f in the interval ir. In this interval, which is the highest point in this interval, where is the supremum of the function f? This is the point in which the function has the maximum value. Let us call it as beta r, such that this is the functional value of beta r, that is nothing but f of beta r equal to capital Mr. Capital Mr is the supremum of the function f in the rth subinterval ir. Thus, there are two points, alpha r and beta r, belong to ir, such that f of alpha r is mr and f of beta r is capital Mr. And remember that alpha r is not any of the n points of the interval ir. Here beta r is one of the n points. But these two points alpha r and beta r need not be the n points. It may be anywhere in the interval ir. Just now we have seen in the graph there exists alpha r and beta r belong to the same sub interval ir such that f of alpha r equals to infimum of the function f in the rth sub interval, namely small mr, and f of beta r is equals to capital MR, where capital MR is the supremum of the function f in the rth subinterval. Therefore, what is the value of capital MR minus small MR? That is equals to capital MR is f of beta r minus small MR is f of alpha r. Then what is the value of f of beta r minus f of alpha r? Alpha r and beta r both belong to the same subinterval, and hence by 1, already we have mentioned f of xr minus f of xr minus 1 is less than epsilon by b minus a, where xr and xr minus 1 both belong to the same subinterval. Therefore, we can write the modulus of f of beta r minus f of alpha r is less than epsilon by b minus a, where r is from 1 to n. This is by 1. Now let us call this inequality as 2. For this partition P belongs to the set of all partitions of the closed interval a comma b, we have 0 less or equal to UPF minus LPF is equals to what is upper dot box sum? Upper dot box sum U of P comma F is sigma r equal to 1 to n capital MR into delta r minus L of P comma F is the lower dot box sum whose value is sigma r equal to 1 to n small mr into delta r. Now what is our aim? Our aim is to show that the difference of UPF and the LPF is less than epsilon. If we show that UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon, then by the necessary and sufficient condition for a bounded function to be Riemann integrable, the given continuous function f is Riemann integrable. So here delta r is a common factor, take it out. Therefore, that is equals to sigma r equal to 1 to n capital MR minus small MR into delta r. That is equals to sum r equal to 1 to n delta r. Now what is the value of capital MR minus small MR? In equation number 2 says that capital MR minus small MR value is less than epsilon by b minus a. Therefore, this equals to capital MR minus small MR is less than epsilon by b minus a. Now, epsilon by b minus a is a constant. Take it out. Epsilon by b minus a is a constant. Take it out. Therefore, the above expression is equals to epsilon by b minus a into sigma r equal to 1 to n delta r. What is the value of sigma r equal to 1 to n delta r? That is nothing but sum of all the lengths of the subintervals of the given interval a comma b, whose sum is b minus a. Therefore, b minus a get cancelled, and hence which is equals to epsilon. Thus, 0 less than or equal to UPF minus LPF is less than equal epsilon. Since we have less than symbol between this expression and epsilon, we have to write 0 less than or equal to UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon. Hence, for each epsilon is greater than 0, there exists a partition P belongs to the set of all partitions of the closed interval a comma b such that 0 less than or equal to u of p comma f minus l of p comma f is less than epsilon. Therefore, by the necessary and sufficient condition for a bounded function to be Riemann integrable, the given function which is continuous is Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b, that is f belongs to R of a comma b, that is f is Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b. Note, there exist functions which are integrable but not continuous. So, the continuity is a sufficient condition but not necessary for integrability. Examples, f of x is equal to x power n is a polynomial where n belongs to n is continuous in the closed interval a comma b, and x power n is integrable on the closed interval a comma b. F of x is equals to log of x is continuous in the closed interval a comma b, and so log x is also integrable on the closed interval a comma b. While proving this theorem, we have taken modulus of f of xr minus f of xr minus 1 is less than epsilon by b minus a. We know that Borel's theorem says that f of xr minus f of xr minus 1 is less than epsilon where xr minus 1 comma xr belong to the same sub interval. But here we have taken epsilon by b minus a, because while calculating the difference of upper dot box sum and lower dot box sum, up to here we get UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon by b minus a into sum r equal to 1 to n delta r. To show that the given function f, which is continuous, is Riemann integrable, by necessary and sufficient condition of a bounded function to be Riemann integrable, we have to show that UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon. To get less than epsilon, while evaluating UPF minus LPF, we get the difference is less than epsilon by b minus a into sum r equal to 1 to n delta r. What is the value of sum r equal to 1 to n delta r? We know that whose value is b minus a. Therefore, to get the difference is less than epsilon, this must be b minus a. So that b minus a get cancelled, and hence we get less than epsilon. For that purpose only, we have taken epsilon by b minus a. F of xr minus f of xr minus 1 is less than epsilon by b minus a. We know that epsilon is very small and b is greater than a. So b minus a is a positive quantity. Epsilon by a positive quantity is much less than epsilon. Therefore, if we take modulus of f of xr minus f of xr minus 1 less than epsilon by b minus a, there will not be any problem. And hence, if we take this is less than epsilon by b minus a, it is very easy to show that upper Riemann integral minus lower Riemann integral is less than epsilon.